Almighty God, you exalted your Son to the place of all honor and authority. Enlighten our minds by your Holy Spirit, that confessing Jesus as Lord, we may be led into all truth. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Of John. From where did he come? from heaven or from man? And they discussed it amongst themselves, saying, if we say from heaven, he will say, then why then did you not believe in him? But if we say from man, we are afraid of the crowd, for they hold that John was a prophet. So they answered Jesus, we do not know. And he said to them, neither will I tell you by what authority I do these things. This is the gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. Invite the children to come forward for children's message.
Missions throughout the world. And through God, They have changed millions of hearts and lives all over the world. That's why we're celebrating their birthday today and remembering how LML has helped so many to raise, confess, and tell their friends and neighbors about Jesus. One more thing before we end here. Did you know every time you say amen, that that means this is most certainly true? Well, let's pray. I'll say a phrase and we get it out.
Dear Jesus,
you have saved us from our sins.
You have saved us from our sins.
And have taught us the truth.
And have taught us the truth.
We give thanks to you.
We give thanks to you.
For faithful servants.
For faithful servants.
Like Martin Luther and the
LWML. Like Martin Luther and the LWML.
Help us always to be ready.
Help us always to be ready.
To confess Jesus' truth.
We confess Jesus' truth.
And we all say,
amen.
Amen. This is most certainly true.
Amen. This is most certainly true.
Thank you. You go back to your seat.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Today we continue our series on being Lutheran, and we're focusing on what it means to be confused. For almost half of human history, there has been a medical technique known as bloodletting that has been the driving theme of how to cure almost every known disease. The first recorded incidents of treating sickness and disease with bloodletting dates back to the 3rd century before Christ. 3,000 years BC, the Greeks were doing bloodletting. It passed on to the Romans and to the others, and bloodletting was considered a legitimate medical procedure all the way up to the 1800s. That's how doctors treated diseases. They thought the problem, the reason you were sick or feeling well, you had too much blood, and if you let some out, then you would feel better. This worked good, never, especially not in the case of President George Washington, who woke up one day with a sore throat. The physician said, well, we can cure that. He's got too much blood. They took 7 pints of blood, and he died 6 days later. Not a good way to treat things. However, modern medicine has clearly come to understanding that that may not be the best treatment for all situations. In fact, bloodletting caused a lot more death than it ever prevented. The reality is that history is littered with other tattered theories that one time held sway but became erroneous. Experiments in medicine, science, and religion. At one time, the map makers believed that the world was flat. We now know that it's a cube. Astronomers once believed that the sun rotated around the earth. We now know that's not true. Chemists once believed that the smallest particle was the atom. We know that's not true. And in fact, not too long ago, in many of our lifetimes, doctors promoted cigarettes as good for your health. I could go on and on with other failures in science and in technology. History is teeming with intellectual errors over time. And it's these past mistakes that make us suspicious as a people, and perhaps even a little bit confused about what we're supposed to believe. We've been wrong so many times that we're fearful of being wrong again. So when somebody comes up with a new treatment, a new technology, a new theology, a new something, we're always a little bit cautious. We don't dive into both feet. We're ready to just kind of let's see what happens. The only thing that we're certain of is uncertainty. We are confidently not confident in much of what we are today. And that's the world we live in today. And today, we give this term postmodernism, where truth is relative and there are no absolutes. Nothing can be said to be absolutely right or wrong. Anyone who teaches with authority is questioned. Their eye was suspicion. But this idea that truth is relative and we're in this postmodern idea world isn't anything new. It goes all the way back, this philosophy, to the time of Ecclesiastes. Remember where Ecclesiastes says, there is nothing new under the sun. So this new modern way of being suspicious and cautious about things shouldn't surprise us. And that's probably one of the reasons that made Jesus such an unpopular character. Because even in our gospel text today, we heard people saying, where do you get the right to teach these kinds of things? By what authority do you teach these? Because Jesus wasn't like the other teachers of his day. The other teachers of his day, all down through history, would say, well, one person would say this, another commentator said this. It could be either one or maybe something different. People didn't teach with absolute authority. Not Jesus. He spoke with authority. Crowds noticed that his teaching was unlike other teachings. Look at Mark chapter 1, where Jesus said, where it says, they were all amazed. So they questioned among themselves, what is this? A new teaching with
authority.
He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him. Jesus didn't teach like others. He wasn't here to confuse and to mumble and to muddy the waters of what we believe, teach, and confess. He taught with authority. The entire civilized world was not used to a religious authoritative teaching. The fact that Christ taught so clearly and plainly, with no confusion, bothered a lot of people. He didn't shy away from his authority. Jesus taught by saying, you have heard it said, but I tell you. Others used to say, but let me make it clear. He didn't cite his sources, where he got his authority from, because he was and is the source of all truth. The truth that we confess when we say, this is the truth. Amen. He is the source. Jesus' teaching was clear. It was strong. It was authoritative. We know this Jesus' authority was true by the evidence of what he did. His word could cast demons out of a possessed person. His words could make a paralyzed person get up and walk, somebody born with palsy. His word, when delivered, could take the most grievous of sinners and pronounce them righteous. By his word. His word could tell the most horrible of hurricanes to be still and stopped. His word could say, let there be light, and light appeared in the universe at the time of creation. His word is the source of authority. And he gives that authority to others. He delegates that authority to those around him. Jesus commissioned the 12 disciples with his authority. Look at Luke 9, where he says he called the 12 together. He gave them power and authority, even over the demons, to cure diseases. He sent them out to proclaim the kingdom of God and heal. So this authority that Jesus had, by being the very nature of God, he could delegate and give to others. He did it again when he commissioned the 72 to go out with his authority to cast out demons. He did it again in the sending of the disciples at the ends of the earth. He armed them with authority. Remember Matthew 28. All authority in heaven and mine, heaven and earth, has been given to me, and I now will give it to you. That authority that Christ spoke with, that he taught with, that was the very nature of himself, has now been given to the church. And the church is not the pastor. Remember the old thing we learned? Here's the church, here's the steeple, open the door and see the people. That's the church. That same authority that Christ gave to the disciples has now been given to us to teach, preach, and confess. Not a wishy-washy, maybe sometimes confused theology, but a truth, a clarity that clarifies our confused thinking. Confusion has been a constant problem for humanity. Even today, we're still struggling with confusion. Should our favorite athletes have to stand for the national anthem? A lot of people say yes. But there are a certain number of people who say no. Confusion. If two people are really in love, shouldn't it make any difference if they're the same gender? Shouldn't they be able to get married? Confusion sown in our culture today. If a man feels like a woman today, why shouldn't he be allowed to use the women's restroom? Confusion in the world today. If God created the world in 6 days, how do we explain the dinosaurs? Casting the confusion. You see, confusion doesn't take place just in medicine or science. It also takes place regularly, even in theology. Our good news
is that Jesus Christ, the one who spoke and the world came into existence, frees us from a life of constant confusion. Christ clarifies our lives. John 1, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we've seen his glory, glory of the only Son, the Father full of grace and truth. John 8, grace and truth comes through Christ. John 8 again, you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. John 17, sanctify them in truth. Your word is truth. If we want to be clarified from confusion, if we want to know the right and wrong answer, if we want a definitive authority teaching, we don't go to MSNBC or to Fox News or to any other media outlet. His word. His word is truth. That's the very purpose for which Jesus came in John 18. The purpose I was born, the purpose for which I've come, to bear witness to the truth. You see, when we have the truth, confusion is dispelled. It's cast aside. Jesus replaces our confusion with the truth of his infallible, inerrant, inspired word. Jesus puts us on the right side up of a world that seems to be turned upside down. And because of Jesus, you and I, the church, who've been delegated the authority and at his ascension, now have the right and the purpose to make a clear confession of our faith. We have been given the authority to speak truth in the world today, to make a clear confession, to live our lives not in doubt, not in uncertainty, not in confusion, but in clarity based upon the truth of God's word. You think with clarity, you believe with clarity, you confess with clarity. Jesus Christ frees us. From a life of confusion. Those so-called hard questions of today aren't hard at all when you have the truth of God's word. And that's what it means to be a Lutheran in today's world. It means as Lutherans, we are opposed to confusion. Being a Lutheran Christian means that we know what we believe. We don't have to wonder or guess. We know where a teaching, a doctrine, a passage of Scripture clarifies the issues of the day. We know how to explain it to others. We know how to defend our faith. Spiritual confusion is not an option for Lutheran Christian believers. It shouldn't be an option for any Christian believer, but most certainly for those of us who are raised in the confession of our faith. Luther described being a Christian as being one of a perpetual student. Because there are always issues that will come up. There are always things that will try to throw confusion into the clarity of our confession. Luther put it this way: I must still read and study them daily, yet I cannot master the catechism as I wish. But I must remain a child and a pupil of the catechism, and am glad to remain so. How many of us have read our catechism in 6th, 7th, or 8th grade at one time or another? Now don't raise your hand, but how many of us have said that's the last time we read it? I don't want anyone to feel guilty. Well, I actually do. I just don't want other people to know. But you see, we live in a confusing in a world that is filled with murkiness, and people will try to confuse what we believe, teach, and confess by bringing all kinds of seemingly reasonable logic into the world. And if we're not clear on our beliefs, which are taught clearly in the Word of God and expounded clearly in the Catechism, we